Elizabeth Ingram for the past many years. She kind enough, and ECFMG is kind enough. Her predecessor was with us in Pakistan in 2005-06, and had a wonderful trip for many presentations throughout Pakistan, and I hope Elizabeth will come with us one day. And she promised she will. So what I want to talk today, I think, is already Adil and Aftab has done a phenomenal job in showing you what is needed to be the best in what you're doing. And I am also, whenever young physicians talk to me, as many of you do, know that I give a very simple example. So if you have a hammer and someone asks you to break this table, you keep hammering throughout the table, you will never break it, right? But if I say just break this glass where the black spot is, and you keep hammering that spot, no matter how hard it is, sooner or later you will break it. So I have a very good colleague, Dr. K, I would say. He wanted to do, he was a graduate of Sindh Medical College, average student. He wanted to do dermatology. And you probably know how difficult it is to get into dermatology. So he didn't care about his numbers, he didn't care about what else. He spent at least 2 years in research, got into internal medicine residency program, finished internal medicine residency program, then got into a dermatology residency program, finished his dermatology residency program, and now he was a faculty at Harvard, and now has a private practice in Boston in New Hampshire. So you can do many, and Adil is another example. For example, if you commit to what you want to do, you will get it done. So my presentation, Elizabeth and I were working on a very important, what you call, situation about foreign medical graduate. As Aftab has shown you, that certain percentage of residents will not match. This is real fact, and we have to deal with that fact. But as you also know, as healthcare is transforming in the United States, it's not only physicians who are needed for that health force. There is more than ever PAs involved with healthcare system. There are more than ever nurse practitioners are involved with healthcare system. And think about this. You have a trained workforce who has trained for many, many years, is a very knowledgeable workforce. Certain percentage of that workforce is not going to get into residency program. And as an organization, APPNA, and as an organization, ECFMG, who certifies those people that yes, you are ready to be trained for medical practice. Can we do something for them? Can we have a path for them to be part of this workforce? And that was the idea. So, but I'm not going to talk too long because you have many great speakers, and this message is not to discourage you for what you want to do. This message is how, as an organization and people, you have to be feeling good what you're doing. If you don't get into residency, then what other things makes you feel? I'm setting an example. I have never done residency. I have done my fellowship in genetics in 1990. In 1998, 1999, and I did my two fellowships, one in one part of genetics, one in another part of genetics, and got into a faculty position at Tufts, and then a faculty position at Baylor College of Medicine and MD Anderson, and now I'm a professor of pathology and director of fellowship program in genetics at Wilbert Einstein for many years, founding director of College of Genetics Fellowship. And that fellowship does not require you to be a trained clinical pathologist or trained clinical OBGYN or pediatrician. All is required that you are ECFMG certified or PhD from one of the accredited programs. So there are paths you can take which may be as good as doing, if you, for example, as Adil was saying, that if you want to be a surgeon, right? If you want to be a surgeon, it's, you have to keep trying that. But if you have a desire to be part of workforce and enjoy something you're doing, that is the path you have to take. I love my job. I love going to work every day in the morning, and I love to read new articles. Every day something new about genetics and molecular pathology, molecular diagnostics. It's becoming part of whole medicine. So this is a wonderful area. So what I have certain resources. I'm going to leave it here. But Faisal, is it possible to put this PowerPoint on website? So all these resources will be available on website. So I'm not going to go and then this is a presentation which was focused for people who want to look at alternate careers, and it will be available. We will have we have talked about it at ECFMG and KLA seminar. We will keep it there also, and hopefully up on our website also. So, but in the end, I would say one important thing, which is really a crux of what the message is today. It's a Urdu verse, and I'll explain it in English also. Visale yaar bhi badi cheez hai magar hamdam. Visale yaar, we all want something. So visale yaar bhi badi cheez hai magar hamdam. Visale yaar fakat aarzoo ki baat hai. So it has to be more than aarzoo. You have to keep trying, you have to work hard. It is that whatever your dream is, or whatever your passion is, it's a very good thing to do. But it's not only desire which will take you there. So you, visale yaar bhi badi cheez hai magar hamdam, visale yaar fakat aarzoo ki baat nahi. And I'm going to end it here, and I'll be happy to have a part of the discussion as well.
Since one of our presenters, Dr. Adnan Qureshi, professor of neurology, couldn't able to make it, so we had a couple of our really great aspirations for residency applicants and a very well maintained CV who's applying to this year, and I would like to call Nizar Nurari if he's around to give a little bit of his
Hello, good morning everyone. Thank you so much for IDC for this opportunity. It is knowledgeable enough to help you be where you want to be in the next 5 years. So I think that is something that that one must keep in mind. Just a few points to remember. I'll be really quick with my talk here. First thing is that your mentor should have a proven track record of mentoring students socially. One must not look for advice from anyone who has opinion on anything under the sun. Somebody who has a proven track record. So please keep that in mind if you're looking for a research mentor. Another thing is someone who is well established in that respective field that you're interested in. It's very important. Like I said, resources are extremely important when you're looking for research opportunities. Finally, someone who has similar research or clinical interests. So you may not just spend time with them, but also excel in the field that you're interested in. Second thing is that I'd like to talk about is how to elicit a favorable response from a potential mentor. Well, technically it should not be difficult because if somebody has been mentoring students, that usually means that you know you must or you should or you can get a favorable response. However, your communication is something which is going to determine. Dr. Heather and Dr. Khosa have already spoken about how important communication is, but I'd just like to keep tell you a few things that you should keep in mind when you're communicating with your mentors. Please remember these are busy people, so something which is precise and to the point and clear is going to be very helpful because it is going to help the mentor understand what your needs are and also help you come across as somebody who's focused about what you want to do. So just a few things to keep in mind. Be clear, precise, and concise in your, I know it rhymes really well, but and I came up with this. So be clear, precise, and concise. Be professional and avoid grammatical errors and spelling mistakes in your communication. Be humble. Be thankful that a stranger is who's your potential mentor is ready to put in his years of hard work and his goodwill on the line to recommend you, or is willing to work with you, or willing to put his name on the paper with you. So be thankful and be respectful. Another thing that I like to point out is that your mentor works with you and not for you. So always be respectful to whoever you're asking for help. They may not be able to help, but I don't think that's a reason for you to disrespect them in any way, that you're not helping me or you're favoring somebody else. It's just that, you know, your interests or his might not match. Another thing is that word of mouth is extremely important, and that is what the mentor is ready to do for you by putting in a word for you. But please do not expect your mentor to break the law or break the rules or bypass the system for you. Your mentor is very much part of the system, and it is very important for you to understand that respecting the system is extremely important. Finally, third question that I'd like to address is how to keep your mentor engaged and interested in you over the years that you're working with him. And of course, again, just a few points to keep in mind is you must be punctual in your timelines. You should work hard and not complain about the amount of work that you have. You should stay professional, you should stay humble, you should stay thankful, and of course, you should stay true to yourself and to the reason why you got in touch with your mentor in the first place. And you need to continue to do everything that you did in order to elicit a positive response. Getting respect is it might be difficult, but it's the easiest thing. Maintaining that over a long period of time is the toughest thing. So my advice is to stay true to what you're doing and continue doing what you did when you were initial contact with your mentor. With that, I'd like to pass the mic to Haris and Marina, who are also aspirants. And thank you so much again for the option. Thank you.
Okay, so there's a question that says, what expertise is needed to be assigned a research project? And so there's two essential components. One is the clinical, or the skills that you have as a researcher. And, you know, that includes knowing different study designs and really knowing how to format a research paper. Because for a lot of IMGs, they don't really know the components of that. So that's a good place to start. There's courses offered by Johns Hopkins on Coursera where you can gain specific know-how on certain types of research, for example, meta-analysis and systematic reviews and all of that stuff. Just be able to conduct a literature review and extract data, which is important, and use software, for example, Excel and SPSS to analyze data. For the personality component of it, you know, just being an optimistic person, somebody people want to work with, somebody people you know, want to talk to, be a team player, it's very important. Be punctual and, you know, meet deadlines, you know, to be a more dependable person for your mentor actually wants to assign you work and you can take care of things on your own, which is important. And also, another thing is to be honest. You know, research is a group effort and there will be projects that you can't take on by yourself. So be honest about it and ask for help when you need it. Okay, so the next question is how to get LORs from physicians in the US and Canada who you haven't worked directly with. That's probably not a good idea to just ask a mentor for an LOR. You know, an LOR is a mentor's word that you are somebody that's, you know, hardworking, and anything that they write in the LOR, it is, you know, who you are, and they're kind of putting their reputation on the line for you. So even if you work with somebody remotely, it is appropriate to ask for an LOR. But you should only expect an LOR for the work that you've done. And a common problem that I've seen is that students want a glowing LOR and they haven't put in the work necessary to do that. So That is pretty important. The last thing I want to address is the do's and don'ts of research. And the do's would be make good collaborations, meet as many people as you can, adhere to the deadlines for certain research projects. And if you are coming from a different country, it's always a good idea to get involved in research in your own company. That way you know how to format a paper and you know the basics of where to start. A good idea to finding a mentor is to brainstorm a project that you are, you know, interested in, a field you're interested in, and then reaching out to mentors who do work in that field. It's always a good idea. And then for don'ts, Nazar actually addressed some of those things. So your mentor, you know, there's a difference between being assertive and being obnoxious. So your mentor has a life outside of helping you. So, you know, late night phone calls, I've heard a lot of mentors say that, you know, it's just not appropriate. Getting phone calls very late at night, messages, you know, and it's a good idea to stay professional, you know, address them professionally. Email is probably a good option, and don't have unrealistic expectations of your mentors. They are there to help you, but they're not obligated to help you. And be grateful for your experience. And yeah. That's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. My name is Harsh Khani. Not to be repetitive, kind of trying to flip it up a little bit. I've been asked to also address three questions. How to improve your CV, paid and unpaid research positions, and how to get unpaid and paid research positions, and also how to get relatives in the positions that you are in, actually. So I'm going to actually flip it up and tell you about my experiences and kind of where I'm coming from. Recent IMG grad, 2014, and I've been doing research, had attempts in the steps. I'm sure some of you can relate to that. I know a lot of people have had attempts. So I'm kind of giving it to you from my perspective, what you guys need to do to build your CV. I have a pretty extensive research background, but first and foremost, how to improve your CV. Been delaying it for a while, but I think it's very important to get your step three done and out of the way. I think that will really bring your CV together. People think that, hey, you can do tons of research, this and that. I've seen that step three helps more with matching the positions that you guys need, rather than just having a million research publications. Also, I think something else is very important is the externships and observerships that you guys do at the designated hospitals. That's also very important. Building relationships with the program directors, people you're working with, I think that's so important. Not to undermine paid research positions or underpaid or non-paid research positions, those are also really important. But the goal of research is to get publications, right? So consistency in programs, in hospitals, where you can get research positions, where we can, you know, build these relationships and they can see you over the span of time, over years of time. You don't want to be jumping around to, you know, hospital, doing different research positions, like did one for 6 months now, did another one for like 3 months. No, you need to stay at one hospital, continue your relationship with that hospital and with that program. Let's see. Also, another thing, volunteer positions, those are also great to have on your resume. Volunteering your blood drive, volunteering, you know, at the hospital for this and that. I volunteered, you know, at camp for the disabled. There's so many things you can do for volunteering. There's always stuff you can do. Moving on to how to get paid and unpaid research positions. My second question. I think that, you know, just applying broadly, I think applying, you know, to different positions, all across the hospital, whatever you're interested in, just get your foot in the door. I had a patient once, and she was a head of neuro over Loyola, and it was kind of weird. I was doing a pap smear on her, but she was very nice. She helped me out. I got attached to a PhD student, worked with them. It was great. She helped me out. So also, when you take interest in a research position, you want to look up the person you're working with, see what they've done, look them up on PubMed, go to ResearchGate if you guys are familiar with that. There's a lot of things on there that can be helpful. You know, kind of go into the email or the meeting, kind of knowing, you know, a little bit about the program, the position. The last thing I was asked to talk about was how to get your relatives, wife, brother, sister, to take a position when you vacate. I don't really have experience with this so much, but I think that, you know, it's important to work hard, and obviously you will reflect on the people that, you know, you're bringing into into the position. So work hard and get them to work with you on projects. They can publish with you as well. You know, they don't have to be a part of the system. They don't have to be a part of Emory, wherever you work. You can have them, you know, come on and help you with the research and get published. And through that relationship, you can be like, hey, you know, after you leave, we've been working with so-and-so person. They want to come in. We've worked with them before. You know, so it's kind of like looks good on you and them if you do that. But in conclusion, I think that persistence and, you know, consistency and hard work really pays off. You know, take your step three and keep doing research, keep getting published, reach out to as many people as you can, and thank you very much.
Thank you, Haris, Mariam, and Nizar. Really glad to have these three great residency applicants. And I can't agree more with you in regards to Haris, in regards to with your step three. Those who haven't taken your step three, please, before leaving this room, you know, you should, it should be in your mind. Nowadays, you get more interviews. It's not about the J-1 H-1 visa. Even with J-1 programs, it's more competitive now, and you will get more interviews if you have step three before September. Finishing with that, I would now like to call our panelists so that we can have our direct communication with our applicants and our panelists. First of all, I would like to call Dr. Faiz Bhora. If you can come up to the stage. Thank you, sir. Dr. Faiz Bhora, can you join us? Dr. Adil Heather, can we please request you to come to the stage? Sorry, what's your name?
So I'll get the session started. I'm Faiz Bhora, I'm a thoracic surgeon, also associate program director for general surgery at Mount Sinai in New York. I just wanted to thank a few folks from all our behalfs as well. So special thanks to Faisal and Majid, obviously, for this format and this program. There is one Haddad and one Naeem. Really, and we, you know, we followed some of the groundwork that you guys put together, and this has turned into a really excellent forum and a resource for our young physicians. So we're thankful for being here, and we look forward to talking to you further.
Guys, if you have any questions, you can also write it down and give us to if you don't want to come up to it. Go ahead, Dr. Naveen.
If someone wants to raise their hands, I can.
Yes, somebody has any questions for us, either you can give us your cards, written cards, or you can raise your hand. Dr. Naveen is here, he can help us out. Thank you, Dr. Naveen.
Hi, I'm Aized. I'm a good afternoon. I had a question regarding research in general. I've had some mixed reviews when it comes to the answer to this. For instance, I'll be applying for internal medicine in general. And if I have an opportunity to do research which is not specifically in internal medicine, how does that reflect on when I sit down for an interview season or going through interviews per se? For instance, if I'm doing research in neurology or something that is not specifically in internal med or it's a subspecialty. So kind of like a pros and cons sort of thing. Is it effective? Is it not effective? Should I pursue it or not? Something. Thank you.
I'll take
just
1 minute. I think it doesn't have to be only internal medicine, neurology, or anything would work. If you're good in any branch, what we want to see is that what you're bringing to the program, what you're bringing to the table. So if it's neurology or any other specialty, we just want to see that if you are good in research, you know how to do it, or at least if you are given guidance, you are hardworking and you will follow through. So it doesn't matter that what topic it is, as long as you know that we want to see if you're dedicated, and second, you know what you're doing.
So I think that was a specialized question, but I'm just going to broaden this up, and we hear this all the time. Should you or should you not do research before applying for residency? And there are different ways of looking at this. I have, you know, my opinions. Adil, I'm sure, will have his, as will our other mentors. So my thought is that if you are ready to apply, you are done with your steps and you are ready to apply that year, I do not think necessarily you should delay your application to do research. I think research is particularly helpful if you have a lag time or a lag year, and then absolutely I think it's one of the best things that you can do to enhance your credentials for residency. So that's how I would look at it. Now in certain very competitive disciplines and specialties, it may be worthwhile then to plan to do 1 or 2 years of research. But again, that's a very planned decision, and it needs to be well thought out. It needs to be done with the right mentor at the right institution, such that you maximize your ability to get into that program, or certainly into a program. So that's how I would look at this. Other comments?
Thank you. Before going into research in general, also about should you, the whole question about the subject of research. You know, I think medicine is a very big field and it's a big catch-all field, and so if you had worked in neurology and you were applying to medicine, maybe it looks differently. But what the program directors are looking for is an awesome candidate and a person on the whole. And also they want to look at what you were able to do when you had the opportunity. So if you're applying to orthopedic surgery, or maybe let's not go something so competitive, how about you're applying to psychiatry? And if you couldn't find it, if you go there and say, I couldn't find a research spot in all of psychiatry, knowing full well that psychiatry is underfunded and there are lots of research spots for people, especially people who are working, willing to work without pay and so on, somebody's gonna think, why? Why couldn't you find a psychiatry spot? If you're saying, I always wanted to be a psychiatrist, and you couldn't find a spot in psychiatry, you know, I think that it would look better if you did your research in psychiatry. You see, the whole key, what Faz is talking about, is you have to be looking great on your application for the time that you're applying for. So if you're right after medical school, so there's one person who matched categorical in surgery immediately after medical school, but he was a superstar in medical school, he did electives in the United States, and his board scores were 262 and 272. So that guy applied, he's a perfect candidate. But if somebody else is applying in the same place, you need to be that great candidate. And if it takes 2 years of research to get there, then so be it.
I think just I want to elaborate on that one. When the programs they are hiring, they are not, I mean, our program in internal medicine is 10 residents. I'm not looking for 10 researchers. I know one or two will be fine. So the program we want to have, very, very diverse program. There will be some people who have excellent, excellent score. There are some who have a lot of research, and there are some that we are looking for that, okay, we need some hospitalists. So they have more clinical experience, or they are good in procedures, or whatever you have. So you cannot change your past. Whatever experience you have, just bring your strength, like someone mentioned. Bring your strength, what you are bringing to the table. And just highlight on that. Nobody is perfect. Nobody is looking for the perfect candidates. They may be like 20% of the candidates may be perfect, and 80% are not perfect. All of us, we are not perfect. The only thing is that what you are bringing to the table, and maybe you think that this person has 260 and I do not have a chance because my score is 250s or 240s, maybe those people, they will match somewhere else. They will match at a university program and you are interviewing at a community program. So give your best, whatever you have, just be honest, straightforward, and just highlight your strengths. One of the things was that was mentioned that being obnoxious, I would just elaborate on that part, is that we had someone we interviewed, didn't match, and had some research interest, and our research person was interested. So we had a good kind of conversation. And after that, he said, okay, you know what, I'm interested in doing observership or something like that. There are limited spots. We can take one or two people. It's a small program. So that person sends the email to me, exactly the same email to our associate program director, and same with the change of name to our coordinator. So we are looking at three different emails. So after a couple of emails, I sent it to, forwarded it to my program coordinator. I said, you know what, put it on the waiting list for the observership. And then 2 days later, every day I'm getting that same email, just to update. And there is no update. We do not answer those emails, it doesn't mean we don't read it. It's just like, it's a policy, we cannot answer all those emails. So I was talking to my program coordinator, I said, you know what, this guy, I already forwarded you this email, and but this one, I'm getting this email every day. And maybe he's overdoing it, and maybe we should pull this one from that list. And we were just thinking about it, and my associate program director comes in. He said, Aftab, this guy's obnoxious. He doesn't respect our time. I got this email 2 o'clock in the morning, and I didn't ask him what he was doing 2 in the morning, but he sent, and I think this person is going to be pain in whatever. And I said, okay. I sent it to the program coordinator. I said, no, this person is not here, and this is what we are having. What if this person comes here and joins us? So you have to look at all those things.
It's important to show maturity. I think, you know, really that's the bottom line. It's professionalism and maturity will take you far. Next question.
Thank you. Before going in, I was just told that Dr. Wasique Mirza is here. I would like this, like him to come up to the stage and join our panel. Thank you. Dr. Wasique Mirza is Associate Professor of Internal Medicine and Acting Program Director of the Wright Center in Pennsylvania. Thank you. Our next question coming from the audience. What recommendations would you have if I am done with all steps, no attempts, graduated in 2014, I have a full-time job in insurance health, and cannot do externships or observerships, or even research, which is unpaid? What advice do you have for me?
I think...
apply and see what happens.
Yeah, what it is that... So when you're going there, just say that, okay, I'm not. There are traditional, like typical candidates, and there are non-traditional candidates. What you are bringing is the insurance experience. You are bringing the maturity. I have one person who's like, someone mentioned, maybe 12 years out of residency from Egypt or whatever, has 3 years of experience at Mayo Clinic. So that shows maturity. I know that once that person is done, for sure that person will find a fellowship in GI because he has like 24 publications. So that person is bringing something that other young physicians, they cannot bring. So you are always looking for a diverse program, and when you're looking at that one, what you need to do is that, okay, you know, I'm not traditional. In order to take care of my family, I had to work. And I worked in insurance, and bring the highlight that what experience you're bringing. Maybe they are interested, and down the road, once you're done with the residency, you may have a position in Blue Cross Blue Shield, CMS, whatever, more administrative thing that other candidates, they do not have. Maybe they are looking for someone who's director of their ambulatory care or whatever in a leadership position. So don't be shy that, that you do not have the perfect, you're not perfect candidate. There is a saying that throughout my life, I've been bothered by the things the most, which never happened. So we are always afraid, oh, you know what will happen. My application won't be looked at. Yeah, of course, if you do not apply, it won't be looked at.
And actually, just to add to that, so this year in our program, actually, we recruited 2 people with minimal US experience. Obviously, if your USMLE scores are high, that's the first thing we are looking at. So if you make the cut, highlight what you've been doing. You know, it could be volunteer work. That's something you've done that gives you that added perspective, add to it. You know, if your CV is strong, your personal statement is strong, that does make a difference. Because we're looking at the whole thing. If you graduated 2 years ago, we don't expect that you're here and have had, you know, extensive experience working with people. Sometimes doing an observership here or there for a few weeks may not even be that significant, because we can see through that. That, you know, it's, you just went to someone who knew someone you knew and gave a couple of weeks. So the body of work that you have done, something you have done through your medical school that shows your personality, what you can bring to the program. A lot of people are looking at that. You know, I don't want just someone who is strong academically, but I'm also getting someone who is in my program and brings something new and helps us improve. So there are lots of facets to it, so don't be discouraged.
Quick question from radiology. I think Dr. Atif Zaheer would be able to answer this. Should IMDs apply to new IR integrated residency since each program has 1 to 2 seats?
So this program is fairly new, and you know, we don't really have a very mature sense of how this is going to pan out. But I think it's definitely worth applying to, because you know, I think it has a very good career path for the interventional radiologists who are interested in that, and people who are interested in surgery but not really want to commit to the you know, the lifestyle and that sort of thing. So I think it's certainly certainly a good pathway to apply to. Now, I just want to go back to the previous thing and just want to touch upon something. We've had applicants, so I go through a lot of applications for radiology, and we've had applicants who have a past in at the Wall Street, for example, right? So you kind of say, you know, Wall Street person and a physician, kind of, you know, they don't really quite go together very well. But, you know, the way you put a spin on it is the most important thing. So let's say you've been, as you said, you know, you've been in life insurance or something. You know, say, you know, I'm interested in healthcare economics, right? I mean, that's how it is. So this is, you know, my experience here would really help me to further my career in medicine that way. So that's always important. And also, you know, as one of our panelists said, that, you know, it's not what you know, where you are doing something, it's like what you're doing. So, for example, we have a lot of people who come to Hopkins and do observerships or research. But, so let's say one person has spent a year here at Hopkins, you know, doing research. So it's not going to be like, okay, I'm going to look at the implications of your name and then say Hopkins or Harvard or whatever big institution you've been at. It's what you've done there. And the more time you spend there, the expectations are higher. So if you spend a year, you know, you would expect a few publications there and, you know, some glowing letters of recommendations and really judge from that. And again, you know, those letters of recommendations, you know, everyone can write you a letter of recommendation, but there are certain keywords that you're looking for, you know, especially towards the end of the letter, like, you know, this was, the, you know, one of the top, you know, 5% or 1% people I've worked with, or this guy is really the best I've ever worked with. You know, simply saying that he's a very enthusiastic and keen learner and that kind of thing is not going to quite do it. So I'm not saying that you can change the letter, but you can actually work towards getting that letter. That's very important.
Thank you. I have a question. Publications, which is important, especially in diagnostic fields like radiology or pathology.
So I think it's kind of a mixture of both. If I may, you know, so let's say you have one, you know, New England Journal paper, right? I mean, obviously that weighs more, but, you know, as we say, that you have to add fiber to your CV, you know, fiber. So meaning, like, yes, you know, you're working with one main thing, that is your main goal, and you obviously have to work on, you know, something useful. You cannot just be writing garbage. But again, you have to be building CV, so, you know, you're also looking at some of your second and third author papers where you were just collaborating, so just to show that you're a team player and you're helping others also. So, you know, yes, numbers do matter in a certain respect, but then again, important publications, for example, it's not probably not that important right now, but when you move up in your career, you'll be like, what was that one publication that you wrote that sort of changed the practice, or, you know, that added significantly to the practice, or to the field of radiology, or for any field for that matter. So, yeah, it's a mixture of both, so that makes it hard, that, you know, you have to sort of work really hard, but at the same time, think about what good projects that you can work on.
Interesting question I would like to bring up as well from the audience, came up from the audience. I graduated in 2011. Can I apply to a program which says that they can't take a candidate which is outside 5 years of graduation? And next question is, what do you mean by average score? So we can highlight on these two questions.
The first part, I'll take the first part where they say that it's out of 5 years or whatever. If you have more than whatever that requirement is, that part is not covered by the filters, if you would, but if you make an exception, then you need to know, if, like, let's say that if I'm making exception that this person is older than 5 years, which is our criteria, then I have to justify why I'm inviting this person, what I'm looking for, what that person is bringing extra that other candidates they are not. So that's what I would say for the non-traditional candidates.
And again, I think it depends on how the program phrases it. Like a lot of programs don't give you a cut line and say absolutely no one before five, because they will be taking some people past five based on the experience, and there are some excellent candidates. So it's usually always like a soft line. So if you have enough on your CV, and in our program, actually we say 5 years from your last major degree. So if you have a fellowship in Pakistan, or if you did an MRCP, or you did a PhD, you know, that date counts. So if you finished your residency, if you graduated 7-8 years ago, but you have been in academic field, actively training in a different facility, where people come from Middle East, they've been working in a facility where actually they are being governed by ACGME rules, those things do count. You know, the gap, if there's none in between and you have not been doing much, then it makes a difference. So you have to see what exactly they're looking for.
I would say that one thing would be that when you are in interview, just for a minute, flip that your role and think that if you are program director, and if you are program director and you have the same profile of the candidate sitting there, why would you hire that person? So be ready to answer that. Okay, you know what, I'm program director now, and I'm 5 years out, and the question is, why should I hire you? What is my answer to that? What, again, if you are non-traditional candidate, you have to bring something extra. You cannot be like, that. Oh yeah, you know what, 5 years I'm out of medical college, and I was just sitting at home doing nothing. You're not gonna get hired.
Just to answer the second part regarding scores, what's an average score, what's a good score? Of course, it depends on your specialty, but in general, for surgical specialties, general surgery, we tend to look at 240 or higher. Now, these are not red lines. They're soft lines, so it depends on your overall package, and it would be slightly different, perhaps, for the medical specialties as well.
Right, I think it depends on each specialty. We are looking at, I think the number that says on the website is 210, but then on average we are looking at 225 or higher. But it does not mean, again, we are looking at the whole application. So the reason we give a soft line is so we are able to get people who may have lower scores, but they bring something else. So there's always room. You just have to sell yourself to show what you can bring.
A question for Liz. Does ECFMD publish any list for individual programs mentioning percentage of AMDs versus IMDs?
So is this on?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So is the question, do we publish a list of programs
individual
that host?
Yes.
Yeah. No, we do not. We do not.
So that might be helpful. Is that possible, perhaps, to generate something like that down the road, so that folks know which programs perhaps might be, you know, so-called IMG friendly?
Yeah. So it is something we've talked about, and we would of course need the cooperation of the individual programs.
Yeah.
One indicator might be if you look at the resources on the ECHO website. So those program directors who have volunteered their time to say, this is what a great residency interview is, this is what a great letter of recommendation is, those individuals are all from programs that host IMGs and that welcome IMGs. So that would be a very small start to that.
Yeah, the problem with that part is that the percentage of IMGs keeps on changing. That we're not going to have all 100%. Maybe there may be some exception to the rule. But percentage, when you go into the match, you do not know what you're going to get. So you may be 50% IMGs, you may get 60%, you may get 40%. So that one, most of the candidates, the best guide would be if you have your senior or the people who applied or you are working with APPNA, they will give you those resources that this program is better. But one word of caution I'll tell you that if you have 10 candidates, and all of them, they have 3 reference letters from same 3 people saying exactly the same thing. After the 10th, I said, you know what, you want to quiz me on this LOR? I know everything. I know the number of beds in this hospital where they're working. And then, you know it, your program coordinator knows it, and everybody else, they say, oh yeah, Honestly, I have words for those one, three-letter word on that one, that this is the same profile. Exactly same word for word.
Question for Dr. Hussain. How does neurology compare with other specialties when you apply for residency? It's hard to compare with.
I think it's hard to know for sure, and my disclaimer is that I'm not a program director. I've never been a program director, and I don't look at applications. I have nothing to do with the residency program. I am a fellowship director, and I'm a journal editor, and I do look at research. My bias would be that neurology is probably as competitive as the average medicine residency program, but I think it really depends on the residency or the institution to which you are applying. You're applying to Duke University. I would imagine it's a fairly competitive process. But the larger the institution, interestingly, I found that the more willing they are to accept foreign medical graduates. And the smaller the institution, the harder it is. And it may be a perception thing, I suppose, that larger institutions don't have the concern that having extra FMGs or IMGs, whatever the politically correct term is, that it makes them look any worse than other institutions. But again, you know, this is sort of an unfair question. I think it goes back to something perhaps what Adil said, that if you are worried about which residency program to apply to, perhaps you're not at the right stage of application. It should not be a question about whether you're applying to neurology or internal medicine. You should have a passion to apply to one or the other. If you want to be a cardiologist, you should apply to an internal medicine program. You should not be applying to a neurology program. If you want to be a neurophysiologist, absolutely. You know, this is what you should do. You should apply to a neurology program. If you have not gotten to that stage, you should get to that stage and then worry about applying. I think that's where the motivation, the dedication comes in. I'll also throw in a bit about research. If my colleagues ask me to look at an applicant and say, you know, look at his research, that's fine, but why are you doing research? Are you doing research in order to get into a program? That's the purpose of research? If that's the purpose of research, it's not going to be high quality work, it's not going to be dedicated work, it's not going to be meaningful work. You're probably better off spending that time doing something else that shows how motivated you are, what kind of a person you are. To work on research just so you can put it on your CV and then forget about ever having done this is sort of meaningless. If you are the 14th author in a 35-author publication, not particularly meaningful. But the one thing is that if you have your name on a publication, you better know that paper. Because if I look at a publication, something interests me, you know I will ask you about how did you do this and what was the result? And if you have no idea what the methodology was, then that will not look favorably. So I don't know if I've answered the question, but
I think I just want to elaborate on what Dr. Hussain said, that, you know, I think bigger institutions would appreciate your research much more than a smaller place, because then they can find use for your work somewhere else, and they have a more sort of a welcoming thing to your research as opposed to a smaller place, but we're sort of more looking for a person who can do the clinical job better.
I think that may be true, but I would also caution that, you know, research in residency is difficult. Most residencies are clinical programs. There are, I'm sure, certain pathology perhaps surgery residency. I know in our program, neurosurgery has a dedicated research year. But very few programs will carve out time for dedicated research. Certainly internal medicine, 3 years, you're not going to have months upon months to do meaningful research. So when my program director shows to me a candidate that has 14 publications that are high powered, the one thing we're always worried about, is this guy going to fit in? Is this guy really a doctor or is he a researcher? Is he going to be able to do a residency program? And as an internal medicine program director, I'm sure you are faced with these kind of questions.
Yeah, that's always a concern because, and we have done that. We actually had a resident who was so highly ranked in research coming from actually did a number of years of research in Stanford and then had clinical experience too, so we were able to get him in. But it took a while just to take the rust off.
Hey, hey,
announcement?
hosting you.
And then we'll get a picture taken.
Next, I would like to invite Naveen Rahman, please. Have Naveen Rahman. Thank you. And last, but definitely not the least, Marina, Haddad. Thank you. Thank you much for coming. And can we have a clap for Marina, Haddad, please? Thank you. And one more person, Namirah, Jamshed, can you please come on? If you're still there. Dr. Saba, Wasique, please. If you're around. Thank you. Anybody else in the committee to make sure this event is organized perfectly. A big round of applause for them.
Chance of serving as a chief here and interacting with a lot of residency applicants. And we are hosting this event and discussions for our three lawyers. And we'll open the session for the question answer sessions for any, if you have any questions, answer sessions for any of our judges.
Doing the presentations first, so we invite Ms. Marina Haddad for her presentation. Big hand of applause, please. Thank you.
Become a U.S. citizen eventually. So the first thing we're going to discuss is really the national interest waiver and the perm visas. So the national interest waiver and the perm visas have very few differences, but they're actually significant in a sense. So the national interest waiver, you don't need a sponsor, you don't need an employer to sponsor you to get a visa. You don't need a prevailing wage requirement, which basically means you don't have to go through the Department of Labor to get any kind of information, and then the requirement is that you have to submit to 5 years of commitment to that agency that you're working with or the hospital that you're working with. With the national interest waiver, you can adjust your status immediately, but you can't be approved until the 5 years are up, and we'll talk about that a little bit more. For the perm visa, you actually have to be sponsored by an employer, meaning a hospital or a research agency or whatever it may be. You do have to go through the Department of Labor to be able to get that visa, and then the adjustment of status happens within 3 years. So we'll start with the national interest waiver. The national interest waiver bail can get, and there has to be an interested government agency in return. It does lead to a permanent legal residency green card, and then within a few years you'll be able to adjust your status to a U.S. citizen. The qualifications for the national visa is that you don't need an employer to sponsor you, like I discussed previously. You must have an employment contract that is valid 6 months before you start applying, and that it's valid for 5 years moving forward. You need to get an endorsement from an agency. So if you're doing research and the National Institute of Health, for example, needs your expertise, they will write you a letter or some kind of qualification saying that they do need your expertise. And you need to submit that with your application to USCIS. The
benefits of the national visa waiver is that you don't need to go through the Department of Labor. The Department of Labor can be a very tedious process. It could take more than 6 months, especially if they decide to audit you through the process. You don't have any competition with U.S. workers, meaning there's nobody else applying for that job. They don't need to advertise it whatsoever. There's no salary minimum or salary determined by the Department of Labor either. So the restrictions, though, are a little bit, you know, they're not that significant, but they are some restrictions. So you can't be approved for the green card until the 5 years are completed. You may apply anytime, but you can't be approved before the 5 years is up. The area of service that you're serving in has to be underserved, meaning an area that doesn't have a lot of doctors, for example, or an area that doesn't have a lot of researchers, and that determination can be changed, or that designation can be changed while you're doing it, but you still would qualify for the green card. Now, the PERM program is an abbreviation for the Program of Electronic Review Management. What it is that you need to go through a labor certification which allows foreign nationals to obtain employment-based immigrant visas in the United States. It's also known as the PERM labor certification. The requirements are a little bit different than the national interest visa or national interest visa waiver. Unlike that one, you do need to have an employer sponsor you for this kind of visa. You must have an employment offer before you can apply for anything. The employer is actually responsible for all expenses that lead to finding this person, which in this case would be you. They are responsible for the attorney fees, they're responsible for putting ads in the newspaper. We'll just discuss that a little bit more. You also have to go through the Department of Labor to get what's called a prevailing wage determined. That could take 6 months, like I said, and it could take longer, and if you get audited, and you would have to submit a lot of evidence to show that. So for somebody to qualify for that, there's a few things that the employer has to do. They have to put an ad for 30 days with a state agency, meaning, let's say you're in Maryland, they would have to put an ad for that position in a Maryland state agency saying that they're looking for that person with certain qualifications to get the job. They must also place 2 advertisements in the local Sunday paper. There are some exceptions to that rule, but we're not going to go into that right now. Again, another one of the requirements is that they have to post internally for that position, meaning they have to give an opportunity to people who are in that hospital or into that research agency to apply for that position. And they have to go through the interview process and they have to vet them out to make sure they don't qualify for that position. They also have to go through 3 additional methods to recruit for that position. And now they also have to show that they have the financial ability to pay for your position for those 3 years that you're going to be there, or however long your employment contract is with them. Now, for you to qualify for that position, you have to show that you actually qualify for it with your education, with your experience, with your research, or training, or whatever it may be. Now, you can apply for the green card within 3 years of that employment. There is another kind of visa that I want to talk about, and then I'll pass it on to either Naveen or Asad. The EB1 visa, it means that you have an extraordinary ability or outstanding professor research, and you qualify to get a green card based on that. This is a more stringent process. It has a lot of more requirements to show. There's a lot of evidence that you need to submit, and you need to be really into research. This is more for people that are into the academia or want to go into academia in the future. So the requirement for this is that you must demonstrate that you have an international recognition for your work. So that means you either have 3, so let's say you want to go into academia for teaching, you have to have 3 years of teaching experience or research in that specific academic area that you're trying to get into here in the United States as well. Your purpose of coming to the United States can't just be for, you know, a couple of years and then you're leaving. It has to be that you're seeking a tenure track at a research position at a university or a higher education, or, you know, it could even be the NIH or whatever organization. Now, to qualify for this kind of visa, there